Good morning and welcome as we gather to celebrate our Mass today on this 21st Sunday of our ordinary season. As we gather, we acknowledge the traditional custodians of country throughout Australia. We recognise their continuing connection to lands, waters and communities. We pay our respects to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander cultures and to elders past, present and emerging. And we sing our entrance song, number 62.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. I who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who make the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Now I am Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
This weekend, the churches of Australia are intentionally praying for the people who have been impacted, especially by the COVID-19 pandemic, especially those in places where they're experiencing incredibly severe lockdowns and difficulties at this time. But it's also good for us to remember the people of Haiti, a poor country that is suffering another catastrophe with earthquakes last week. We think of the people of Afghanistan and the incredible challenges that are now happening there as there is a change of regime and they return to Sharia law in a very violent way. But there's also the needs of our own community, the people in our own parish and family and friends who are struggling for whatever reason at this time. And so let us just bring all of those people into the community that is our community, standing around the altar of the Lord. And let us pray for them and pray with them that they will have peace and harmony in their lives. And to make the start of that, can we turn to somebody and be a prayer partner for today, please?
Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy. Christ eleison, Christ have mercy. Christ eleison, Christ have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
From the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel together at Shechem. Then he called the elders, leaders, judges and scribes of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. Then Joshua said to all the people, "If you will not serve the Lord, choose today whom you wish to serve, whether the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are now living. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." The people answered, "We have no intention of deserting the Lord our God, who brought us and our ancestors out of the land of Egypt, the house of slavery, who worked those great wonders before our eyes and preserved us all along the way we travelled and among all the peoples through whom we journeyed. We too will serve the Lord, for he is our God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
I will bless the Lord at all times, his praise always on my lips. In the Lord my soul shall make its boast. The humble shall hear and be glad.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
The Lord turns his face against the wicked to destroy their remembrance from the earth. The Lord turns his eyes to the just and his ears to their appeal.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
They call, the Lord hears. And rescues them in all their distress. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and those whose spirit is crushed he will save.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Many are the trials of the just man, but from them all the Lord will rescue him. But he will keep guard over all his bones. Not one of his bones shall be broken.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
Evil brings death to the wicked. Those who hate the good are doomed. The Lord ransoms the soul of his servants. Those who hide in him shall not be condemned.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord.
From the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Give way to one another in obedience to Christ. Wives should regard their husbands as they regard the Lord, since as Christ is head of the church and saves the whole body, so is a husband the head of his wife. And as the church submits to Christ, so should wives to their husbands in everything. Husbands should love their wives just as Christ loved the church and sacrificed himself for her to make her holy. He made her clean by washing her in water with a form of words, so that when he took her to himself, she would be glorious with no speck or wrinkle or anything like that, but holy and faultless. In the same way, husbands must love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man to love his wife is for him to love himself. A man never hates his own body, but he feeds it and looks after it, and that is the way Christ treats the church, because it is his body, and we are its living parts. For this reason, a man must leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two will become one body. This mystery has many implications, but I am saying it applies to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Your words, Lord, are spirit and life. You have the words of everlasting life.
Alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
From the Gospel according to John. After hearing his doctrine, many of the followers of Jesus said, "This is intolerable language. How could anyone accept it?" Jesus was aware that his followers were complaining about it and said, "Does this upset you? What if you should see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh has nothing to offer. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the outset those who did not believe and who it was that would betray him. He went on, "This is why I told you that no one could come to me unless the Father allows him." After this, many of his disciples left him and stopped going with him. Then Jesus said to the 12, "What about you? Do you want to go away too?" Simon Peter answered, "Lord, who shall we go to? You have the message of eternal life, and we believe. We know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This is the fifth and final week of this message series that I'd called Food for the Journey. And because of our slightly challenging circumstances in this liturgical season, this is the third out of the five that you've got. Christ the Priest only got two out of five. So congratulations, you've got a pass mark and they failed. Sort of. It's a reminder to us, this chapter 6 of John's Gospel, of the theology of Eucharist that really puts forward the story for us of who Jesus is in our life and what his giving of life, what his giving of himself really means. Part of the way running through, parallel to this passage from John 6, has been Paul's letter to the Ephesians. And the first week he asked a very serious question. And that's part of the story of what we're about. He made the statement, "I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to live a life worthy of your vocation. And the question then becomes for us, what is our vocation and what does that really mean for us? Because the challenge to live as Christ followers in our world today is countercultural. It's very different from what the world expects. It's very different from the way people think, because it's a way of looking towards other people and respecting and trying to find ways of building the kingdom of God in our day and in our time. Paul said very quickly, he said, you must bear with one another charitably in complete selflessness, gentleness and patience. All those who passed the first test, put your hand up. Because it's really difficult to live in patience with other people and in gentleness and in complete charity. Because it challenges us to say, how do we actually relate to people around us? Not because we do something wrong, it's just that other people impact us. And that challenges who we are. Paul then goes on to say, you must give up your old way of life and you must put off your old self. Your mind must be created renewed by a spiritual revolution. And that's integral to who we are as God's people. It has to be a continual challenge to us to look beyond the way we think, the way I think, and to find how would Jesus act, how would God work in this particular moment and this particular time. And that is not easy, because all of us know we have to change, but very few of us actually want to change. And that's the human condition. And yet Jesus is constantly calling us to this new way of living. Paul, in the letter to the Ephesians, all the way through the letter, is saying it. He's saying, be very careful about the sort of lives you lead. Be intelligent and not senseless people. Think about what you're doing and why you're doing it. Think about how you're living and why you're living in that way. One of the challenges that Paul presents to us comes in our reading today. Many would acknowledge the fact that the reading today poses significant challenges in our world, because it talks about wives in a very language that's patriarchal. And even though there is a complementarity about it, even though there is a sense of equality about it, the language that Paul uses doesn't really highlight exactly what that is. He tells us that we are to treat each other with a gentleness and equality, but he speaks from a patriarchal model which speaks about wives must submit to their husbands just as Christ, we submit to the church. So there is a challenge for us, but I would hope that we don't get caught up in the language of this particular passage and become so struck on the words that we miss what Paul is trying to say. That Paul is trying to remind us that all of us have a relationship with Christ and the church that is modeled in a marriage. But it's not subservience. It's equality. Jesus calls us to be his brothers and sisters. Jesus calls us into a relationship with God. He calls us to live a life worthy of our vocation, and he invites us to recognize the integrity and the beauty of each person. So rather than just write off the letter to the Ephesians by one short part of the passage, he's really saying so much more in this letter and so much more powerfully inviting us to be people who live a life worthy of our vocation. And that sets the scene for today's two readings from the book of Joshua and from the Gospel of John, where Joshua, standing amongst the people as they've arrived in the promised land, now asks them, who are you going to follow? Are you going to follow the God of our ancestors, or are you going to turn to the way the people who amongst whom you are now living, how they follow the various gods of their religious practice? And the people say, no, we will follow the Lord. We want to be his faithful people. And yet we know that their intention and the reality of their lives were quite the same. They knew who God was. They made the statement, you know, was not it the Lord our God who brought us out and our ancestors out of the land of Egypt, who worked these great wonders before our preserved us all along the way and who helped us as we journeyed here. Yes, we will serve the Lord, for he is our God. Their intention was to be faithful, but the reality was that they missed this point numerous times. And that's our story as well. We want to be faithful to God, and yet there are days when we miss. Not by huge amounts, but we just don't quite get it. We don't quite live the way God wants us to live. And that's our humanity. But God works within our humanity. God gifts us with life and grace through our humanity, and he invites us to be people who say yes to this call to live out our vocation as God wants us to live. Because of our liturgical cycle, the beginning of today's gospel can even sound just a little bit strange. It tells us that after hearing this, that his doctrine, many of the followers of Jesus walked away. Now, because we haven't been listening to the passage continually, that might not make a lot of sense. So this is what was happened at the end of last week's reading. Jesus said, "This is the bread come down from heaven, not like the bread our ancestors ate. They are dead. But anyone who eats this bread will live forever." And the people looked at him and said, "What are you talking about? You're talking about yourself as being the life for each one of us. He who eats my body, drinks my blood, will have life in eternity." And they're saying, "You're putting yourself on a relationship, a par with God. How can you do that?" And Jesus knew that that's what they were thinking. He knew that that's the trouble that they were experiencing. He says to them, what would have happened if you actually saw the sun descend from heaven? How would you cope then? And then he goes on to say, "It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh has nothing to offer. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life." And people walked away. Because like so many of us, if it can't be scientifically proved, if we can't see it, then we struggle to believe it. We struggle to accept that what's in front of us is what God is saying to us. In recent times, there have been quite a number of surveys done of believers and what they believe. And less than 40% of Catholics believe that the bread and wine at the Eucharist is changed into the body and blood of Christ. They know it's important and they say, yes, it's what we're supposed to do. But less than half of us believe that it truly is Jesus present amongst us. And that's been going down quite steeply in recent times. Why? Because so much of everything we see, we want to put our hands on, we want to touch, we want to prove its existence. And to live through the eyes of faith is something quite challenging to us. Because it's asking us to step out of our comfort zone and to step into a new way of living, a believing way of living. And that's where people struggle. So Jesus turns to his disciples and he says, "What about you? What are you going to do?" And Peter makes that brilliant statement. He said, "Lord, who shall we go to? You have the words of eternal life, and we believe, we know that you are the Holy One of God." That's what God is asking of us. Are we able to make that statement, not because we know the words, but because we believe the truth that sits underneath it, that Jesus truly is the bread of life, that Jesus truly is our food for the journey of life, that the Spirit he promised us lives within us and through us gives us hope when things are struggles and difficulties. Our God is a God who loves us and who invites us to be in relationship with him, not just in words, but in deeds, in belief, in our hearts, in our way of living. So we come back to those words that Paul asked at the beginning of that section of the letter to the Ephesians, which has been our story with alongside this passage. Live lives worthy of your vocation. And so I invite you today, as we enter into the mystery of the Eucharist, to know that Jesus truly is inviting us to be one with him so that we can become the Christ who lives amongst us. Together, let us now make our profession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. My friends, when we call the Lord hears and remains close to those in distress, with loving trust we now bring our prayers to the God of all goodness.
We pray for those suffering the devastating effects of disasters of all kinds, earthquake in Haiti, Taliban in Afghanistan, and the ongoing COVID pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who are homeless. May they find courage from the good work of those who bring them relief. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the many victims of sexual and emotional abuse at the hands of church ministers and other personnel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the children of our parish, preparing for sacraments of reconciliation and First Eucharist. May the Lord be with them at each step of their journey. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for sick in body, mind, or spirit, especially those mentioned in our newsletter, and all for whom our prayers have been asked. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the deceased members of our families, especially Irvin Keane, recently deceased, and those whose anniversaries we remember. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the special needs of our parish. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our prayer partner. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray together the plenary council prayer.
Come, Holy Spirit of Pentecost, come, Holy Spirit of the great Southland. O God, bless and unite all your people in Australia and guide us on the pilgrim way of the plenary council. Give us the grace to see your face in one another and to recognize Jesus, our companion on the road. Give us the courage to tell our stories and to speak boldly of your truth. Give us ears to listen humbly to each other and a discerning heart to hear what you are saying. Lead your church into a hope-filled future that we may live the joy of the gospel through Jesus Christ our Lord, bread for the journey from age to age.
Amen.
Our Lady, help Christians, pray for us.
Saint Mary MacKillop.
Pray for us.
One bread, one body, one Lord.
One cup of blessing which we bless. And we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Thank you. A Gentile or Jew, a servant or free, a woman or man, no more. One body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless. And we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one.
Pray, my friends, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundation of the world, and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed us in your own image and set us over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name all you have made, and forever to praise you in your mighty works through Christ your Son. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by your Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, Julian, our Bishop, and all those who are called to your service. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all those who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. And have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with Saint Aloysius, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. 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 Amen.
So, my friends, at the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom and the power and glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer those nearest a sign of Christ's peace.
Lamb of God,
Lamb of God,
you take away
the sins of all the world.
Miserere nobis,
miserere nobis,
bread of life. take away
the sins of all.
You take away
the sins of all.
Dona nobis pacem.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of all the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Reminder that next weekend at Christ the Priest we have the Evangelium Conference. In spite of the fact that most of the people who were going to be here from interstate have been in COVID lockdown, the conference is still going ahead through Zoom. So there will be keynote speakers and workshops which will take place. So from next Saturday morning from 9-ish, the conference will start and be held. There is also, for anyone who wishes to attend the evening session, that will be following the 6 p.m. Mass. There'll be soup and sandwich afterwards, and then the final session of the day will be on. And I think we're just inviting anyone who wants to come to that, so don't bother booking, just come, and we'll fight out the problems later. Have a great week. Sorry, Michael. Oh, that's right. We have an announcement. Thank you, Michael.
Hey, everyone. Good morning. Just to bring to your attention a couple of things that are coming up. We've decided to have on the 4th of October a mass for the animals at this parish.
Sorry. Pets.
Pets?
Pets.
And St. Francis of Assisi is on the Monday the 4th. So we'll have it on the Sunday. And a fortnight later, we'll have our annual St. Mary's Luncheon. Again, at Brookside, very successful last year. So please see myself or either Mitch and just signify your intention if you'd like to come. Thank you.
Brookfield. Thank you, Michael. My friends, the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Go now, you are sent forth to live what you proclaim, to show the world you follow Christ, in fact, not just in name. Go now, you are sent forth to walk this troubled earth, to share your faith with other folks, to improve your real world. Go now, you are sent forth as God's ambassador, by serving Christ and those we meet, we love him more and more. Go now, you are sent forth, and Christ goes with you too. Today you help the kingdom come in everything you do.